This is an exclusive excerpt from the Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holden.
Bathrooms are the most essential room in any building. It's also the first word we learn in foreign travel. We're all curious about bathrooms, but usually too bashful to ask questions. Well, Steve Gottlieb knows a thing or two about the bathroom and its history. He's the author of Flush, Celebrating Bathrooms Past and Present. He joins us on the line right now from Maryland. Hi, Steve.
Hello, Peter.
Thanks for being on the program with us. So how did this all start for you, delving into bathrooms and photographing them?
Well, I confess bathrooms were never a particular interest of mine. I am a photographer, but I did photograph a few here and there, and I was giving a slideshow of some photographs to a large group, and when I got to a few bathroom photos, I had an unusually intense reaction. It seemed people were particularly interested in them, and I got the idea that maybe nobody had done a book, and maybe I would, a book of photographs and text about bathrooms, and lo and behold, no one had ever done such a book, so I did one.
What was the reaction you got? What were they intense about?
Well, I had a couple that were a little bit funny. It's hard to describe on the radio, but they were amusing and they got a huge amount of laughter. And then, I could just describe one. I did a self-portrait, I call it, of, shall we say, urine in the snow, my own. And when I described that as one of my best self-portraits, that got quite a reaction. And then I photographed some really unusual ones, and you could just kind of hear that audible, oh my goodness, I've never seen a bathroom that beautiful or interesting or whatever. You could just feel the reaction, you know, like a stage actor feels the reaction of an audience. And in fact, I stopped in the middle of my talk, which I'd never done before, and I said, I'm getting quite a reaction. I wonder if I ever did a book on this subject, would you buy the book? And like, you know, dozens and dozens of hands went up, and I thought, my goodness, I'm onto something. That's how it started.
So when you had that aha moment, you then had to focus literally on bathrooms. So what was the biggest surprise or gosh darn moment for you when putting together this book and collecting the pictures for the bathrooms that you have in it?
The biggest surprise, I suppose, is because I do a lot of public speaking, I found myself in front of a variety of audiences, and I would mention during my talk that I'm working on a book. And I said, if anyone in the audience knows of a really amazing bathroom and can give me a specific location, would you please see me after the talk? So I was doing all these talks, and just constantly people were coming up to me, and I realized that bathrooms, although people don't generally talk about them, leave a huge impression in people's minds because I was getting one idea after another. And then people would give me contact names or send me little iPhone snapshots of things. And then when I got on the road, I had a tremendous number of leads of interesting places to go.
Now,
totally surprised by that.
When you ask for interesting bathrooms, does it say anything as far as you're concerned about the people who suggest bathrooms as to what they find interesting about them?
Each person had, they didn't just say, hey, I know an interesting one. They would describe it and they would indicate why they thought it was unusual. Now, you know, I didn't put them on the couch and ask them why, you know, that bathroom happened to loom large in their memory, but it clearly stuck in there for a variety of reasons. And so I found that most people are turned into being pretty reliable sources about the quality of these. And now I've been giving some talks about bathrooms, and I find the same thing happening. People are coming up to me and saying, oh, I bet you missed the bathroom at such and such a place, and they're continuing to give me locations. So if I ever want to do another book, I already have a couple of dozen great location ideas for the next series of bathrooms.
Now, as a teenager, I worked as a movie theater usher in several theaters. So if you work as an usher, one of the things you have to do between shows is clean the bathrooms. For that reason, it's one of the people who've done the kind of job I've done have an opportunity to go into the bathroom of the other sex. And that's the thing that I find very interesting, because the men's room versus the women's room, it's very opulent in the women's room. There's usually a couch. There's usually an outer room. So when traveling around looking at bathrooms and getting people to talk about bathrooms, were you finding that more women were asking or discussing about bathrooms they'd seen, or men?
Goodness, you got me there. I don't know. All I can tell you is I didn't want to limit flush to men's bathrooms only, and so I frequently would have to have a guard of some sort stand outside the ladies' room while I was in there taking a picture, because I didn't just take snapshots. You know, my pictures are rather thoughtfully composed and lit, so I would have someone out there telling women, you know, not to go in for some period of time. I'd ask the owner, you know, it could be a hotel owner or whatever, and they'd put a barrier up temporarily while I did the photo. And you're right, you know, the women's were a little bit nicer, by and large. But, you know, men are men. What can you say?
Yeah, but, you know, the women's are nicer, but in the grand scheme of things, as I've learned from previous experience, they're not necessarily cleaner.
Well, that's an area that I don't profess expertise in. There are certainly a lot of dirty ones, but I don't know whether I noticed the dirtier ones. I didn't distinguish men or women. It has more to do with location and whether it's a, you know, public bathroom, for example, in New York City subway system. More than half the bathrooms are closed now because they're so filthy. And, you know, it's tough to have a public bathroom in certain locations where, for a variety of reasons, they don't get maintained and they get awfully dirty quickly. So, you know, there are places you want to avoid the public restroom for sure.
Now, the book is called Flush, Celebrating Bathrooms Past and Present. So I'm assuming that besides the pictures, you're also giving a little bit of history about the bathroom in itself, right?
Absolutely, which is a fascinating thing. And, you know, I started this book project really with photography in mind, but as I did research, I found the bathroom world of history and culture and technology absolutely fascinating, as fascinating as any little universe I've ever been in. So I wrote a lot of text about the history of outhouses or toilet paper preferences and things like that, you know, public bathrooms and pay toilets and so on. The bathroom gives you an interesting perspective on the world, certainly did for me, and people who've been getting my book and reading it have been telling me that while they enjoy the photos, they're equally fascinated by the information I provide. And I talk a little bit about my adventures, you know, while I traveled around and how I found things. So it was great fun to create the book, and it's fun to talk about it.
Is there a bathroom that sticks out in your mind as one that impressed you, either good, bad, or indifferent?
Well, there's so many. It's a little bit hard to say. There was a guy who was an artist who created a bathroom where everything in the bathroom was a work of art, you know, except for the toilet, but the whole tiling and the way he did the shower, you know, that's fascinating. I was particularly struck with George Washington's outhouse, which he designed himself. It's what we call in the trade a three-holer. And one of the things I found interesting in taking pictures of some old outhouses is I learned that they aren't just one-holers. There were many that were two, three, and more. In fact, if you go back to Roman times, they basically had outhouses that would be 15-holers. In other words, you could have 15 people sitting thigh to thigh or kneecap in a communal experience, which would almost shock us now. Everybody wants their own bathroom. Houses have, you know, multiple bathrooms, but in the old days, people would sit together, and it was almost like a social place, and we'd have trouble imagining what that's like, but that's the way it was.
Welcome to the plague, I guess, in some cases.
Maybe.
One of the other things, too, and we're just running out of time. I mean, the issue of even how to hang the toilet paper, I think that's as big an issue as how to solve the problem in the Middle East.
I'm not only stunned that people have preferences, strong preferences, but they feel very deeply about the issue. It's not just, hey, I like it one way or the other, over or under, but they can't imagine why other people would do it any other way. So, yes, that's one of the things that I learned in researching the book.
For me, I'm an under person. How about you?
Well, I'm an under, but that puts us in the distinct minority.
I hear that.
It's not a 50-50. It's not a flip of the coin. It's 75% are clearly defined as over. I'm one of the 25%, as are you. and very few people would say that they do it either way.
Yeah. It's a fascinating idea for a book. It's a great idea. The book is called Flush, Celebrating Bathrooms Past and Present. People can also check out your website, which is gottliebphoto.com. Steve, I thank you very, very much for being on the program with us.
Okay, well, I thank you. If I could just mention, if you don't remember Gottlieb Photo, just put in Amazon Flush plus Gottlieb, G-O-T-T-L-I-E-B, and you can find the book. And I thank you very much for your time, Peter.
Steve Gottlieb, author of Flush, Celebrating Bathrooms Past and Present. You can go to my website at thestufffile.com, go to the What's On page for the show, which is show number 0292, and you'll find links to Steve's site, plus links to either Amazon.com or Amazon.ca, where you can order his book directly.
You've just heard an exclusive excerpt from the Stuff File program with Peter Anthony Holder. To hear any or all of the full hour-long shows, visit thestufffile.com. Stuff is spelled S-T-U-P-H. That's thestufffile.com. A presentation of Flying Fish Communications.